Monkeys in love. Monogamous monkeys. Monkeys where the fathers are amazing fathers. Like the group of owl monkeys sitting and sleeping in that tree in the northern forest of Argentina. For the pair of adult titi monkeys giving their early loud duet. We call these primate species peer-leading, socially monogamous, sexually monogamous primates. Why do we call them like that? If you go look for titi monkeys or owl monkeys in the forests of Latin America, everywhere, you'll find them in small groups, like the diagram shows, that only have one adult male and one adult female. The male and the female move around together, coordinate their activities, they do a lot of things synchronously, they eat, they sleep, and they mate and have sex with each other. They also take care of the young in the group together. That's why we say that they have biparental infant care. The care of the infant is provided by both parents. And they have little sexual dimorphism. That's why you need my help to know that the male is the animal in the far left and the female is the animal in the far right. And they have a bond, a pair bond. This development of a relationship between them, long-lasting, enduring, has many, many benefits and is what we call a pair bond. And this is rather unusual among mammals and among primates, so is peer living and having such committed fathers. They even hold hands, I'm sorry, tails together. So what I want to share with you today is the research we have done in trying to understand the evolutionary origin of peer bonding and love. Evolutionary origin. What I'm trying to get at is that we're not only interested in understanding how things are today, but understanding how they came to be. We can only draw what an early Australopithecine may have looked in the past. That's the diagram you have on the left. But we can go and see what a male and female owl monkey do today, in the present. And when we say evolutionary, what we're implying is that we assume that whatever they do today must have had benefits in the past. Those animals who chose to have a pair bond or who ended up having a pair bond, maybe survived longer, maybe they were healthier, maybe they produced more infants. And so their progeny also did the same. And those traits, those adaptations became fixed in the population. So we want to understand what are some of the traits that might have evolved over an evolutionary time that lead to pair-bonded, pair-living owl monkeys and titis. Part of the answer of understanding why mammalian monogamy and primate monogamy, peer bonding, and committed fatherhood is so rare comes down to the mammalian reproductive biology. We have to start there. We have to start there because the female mammal gets pregnant, the female mammal nurses, and that limits the reproductive potential of a female. In the case of humans, a woman cannot have more infants more frequently than every 9 months. And so the number of infants that a female mammal can produce is substantially smaller than the number of infants a male can produce. And that presents us with the first question. Then why? Why for a male it's advantageous to settle in a monogamous relationship where they're limiting their reproductive potential? That is the first question. The second one has to do with the second aspect of mammalian reproductive biology. The conception of the ovum, the sperm fertilizes the egg inside the female genitalia. We have internal fertilization. Therefore, what happens is that there's uncertainty for the male, whether it was his sperm or somebody else's sperm that have really fertilized the egg. So the male is not only restricting its potential, but has an inbuilt uncertainty about whether the infant that he may provide care to, it's in fact his infant. So those are some of the questions that have driven my research all these decades. Why titi monkeys and owl monkeys are pair living? Why are they monogamous? And why are the males so committed to the infants in the groups? For the rest of the talk, I'm going to focus primarily on sharing some information, some hypotheses we have examined, specifically with the owl monkey population in Estancia Huaycolec, in the province of Formosa, Argentina, within the Reserva Privada Monomirquina. On the left, you can see an aerial photo of our field study, roughly 700 acres. You can see in yellow our trail grid that allows us to move back and forth day and night, trying to find these very little sexual dimorphic, small, cryptic owl monkeys. And that's why what we do is we fit them. You can see in the photo of the old monkey a tiny radio collar and a student tracking that monkey with an antenna. That allows us to find them. And we have found them. We have found them very, very frequently over all these almost 30 years. This is a sample of the group that we have found. And every single time that we found owl monkeys in our forest, they are in pairs. Here I'm showing you a schematic of 18 pair-living socially monogamous groups that occupy 18 separate territories. And by noticing this rather homogeneous distribution of owl monkeys, we're beginning to examine a first hypothesis of monogamy, one that has to do with the distribution of resources in space and time. So it is true that the groups are evenly distributed in space, and we assume that that must be because resources are distributed also homogeneously in space. But what has been very, very interesting, that what is not homogeneous, is how successful the groups are in producing offspring. So let me show you the percentage of infants born for territories and groups based on data collected from 1999 to 2023. So on average, a group produces an infant on 75% of the years that we collected data. So 3 infants every 4 years. But that's the average. When you look at the range, it varies between 25 and 95%. It means that some territories slash groups are only producing 1 infant every 4 years. Others are producing infants pretty much every year. So we have a huge variation in their success. We think that much of that variation is because of social factors, which is what's going to take us to the next two hypotheses we want to consider. I told you that the owl monkeys are pair living. What I didn't mention, that that's not the whole story. One of the most important findings of the project has been documenting that besides the groups that I described to you, they are solitary floaters, as those individuals that are to the left and the right of the group, a male floater on the left, a female floater on the right. These are new, relatively young adults that they have left the group they were born. I mean, they left mom and dad, and they went to look for their own partners. And one way each week they can find a partner is forcing their way into a group. So a male floater may kick out the resident male adult. A female floater may kick out the resident female adult. They may disrupt the pair bond that the pair of owl monkeys has. This is sometimes very violent. There's a lot of aggression, and it has very profound consequences for everyone involved. Over the course of the first 10 years of the project, we documented 27 female replacement, 27 times that a female floater moved in, kicking the adult female out, like the photo that I show you on the right. That is an adult female that we found dead following the fight she had with the female floater. 23 male replacements as well. So these floaters are disrupting pair bonds, are disrupting the relationship already established, and that has consequences. So let me show you some data on how successful pairs are when they are not disrupted and when they are. When a pair of owl monkeys manages to just stay with each other for their lives, on average, in 10 years, they will have about 8 infants. That's the box on the left. Now, if one of the, if either male or the female are forced through one of the floaters to repair, then usually they produce about 6 infants in a decade. So that's about a 20%, 25% decrease in their reproductive success. It's a huge effect that the floaters are having. Now, another possibility for explaining why we see pair living, monogamy, and fatherhood has to be precisely with biparental care and committed fatherhood. Maybe what happens is, like, by recruiting the help of the male in the care of the infant, both mom and dad benefit. If the help of the male is increasing survival, or it's allowing mom to have more infants, then that may explain the evolution of monogamy in the first place. Male titi monkeys, male owl monkeys are some of the best fathers in the world. Except for nursing, they're doing it all. And they're doing it all from the very first few days, transporting the infant playing with the infant, sharing food with the infant. I want to show you now a video. It's about 30, 40 seconds long, but I want to give you a little bit of an explanation before I play it. Our monkeys have usually singletons, one baby a year. But in 2011, two groups had twins. Here we're going to look at how a male owl monkey handled both twins. Even in the presence of twins, he was alone moving them around. You will see first the female on the right side. The male is going to move to the left with the twins. Eventually, a juvenile at the end joins the male. And at the very last, mom. So please notice how mama and dad are rather apart, and dad is moving ahead, going first with the infants on the back. So let's play the video. That's the juvenile, and now it's going to come mom. So you can see, the male is transporting two infants that altogether, those two infants combined are probably about 20% of the weight of the male, right? If you are, say, 160 pounds, that would be like you transporting 40 pounds all the time. So the male is making a huge effort in caring for the young. So the next question is, okay, but he's making a, I told you about internal fertilization. I mean, is he really providing that support to his own infant? So we're getting at really answering the question, are we looking at biological fathers taking care of the young, or are we looking at stepfathers? So we need to make a distinction between sexual monogamy, a male and a female mating, copulating with each other, and genetic monogamy, a male and a female only copulating with each other and only producing infants with each other. And in the last 30 years, with the molecular genetic revolution, the way in which we answer this question is by collecting biological samples from the animals and assessing paternity, evaluating with genes, with genetic material, if in fact dad, the male, and the infant are indeed biologically related. We did that with three populations, one of our monkeys in Argentina, and two populations of titi monkeys. In Argentina, we detected 100% genetic monogamy in 126 infants. That's a huge data set for something like this. A similar pattern was found with smaller data sets for genetic monogamy in two populations of titi monkeys in Peru and Ecuador. So now we know that these males are in fact taking care of the young. Does it pay off? Does it pay off that we have a system of biparental care? One way in which we can assess that is how well infants survive. And owl monkeys and titi monkeys have some of the highest infant survival rates among all primates. Almost 90% for owl monkeys, 91% for the titis, with a very, very decent sample size of infants that we have evaluated. There are benefits. There are benefits to having a biparental care system that is reflected in survival, but I also told you that there's disruption of that system. So another way in which we can assess the benefits is by examining the costs when the pair bond is disrupted. And I want to show you now the last piece of information that I want to share, which is some data documenting that the loss of the biological father is affecting infant survival more than the loss of the mother. So when we have those plotters moving in and creating havoc in the group, that has a bigger effect when dad is replaced than mom. On the left of the graph, you see survival with both biological parents. The data in the middle of the graph is showing you survival with the stepfather, meaning the biological father was replaced. And you can see a drop from the, let's call it the baseline situation with both biological parents. And last, to the right, survival with the mother, which is about the same as survival with biological parents. So with that, let's wrap up some of the main points that I would like you to take home. The first one summarizes the whole, pretty much the whole presentation. So pair living and pair bonding very likely are increasing father certainty. and father exposure to infants. We think that this may be promoting the evolution of paternal care, which is related to increased infant survival, which does result in an increased reproductive success for both parents. Still, competition with solitary floaters negatively affects the duration of pair bonds, infant production, and survival. And last, we want to make the point that following the loss of a pair mate, individuals show resilience. This is something that's very, very difficult to document studying captive primates. But in the wild, we're showing that the animals, after their bond is broken, they can develop a bond with a new partner and reproduce again. Resilience and repairing and rebonding. How is this important for, in the words of CARTA, exploring and explaining the origins of the human phenomenon? I thought a lot about this, and I settled for two main points, two main topics where I think we're making a contribution. The first one is about biological sex differences, competition, and mate guarding. It's very difficult to find evidence on sex differences of early hominins, of fossils. One way in which we can do that, and we can connect those sex differences with behavior, is by looking at sex differences in non-human primates. Like that male and female owl monkey in the middle photograph where you could not tell the differences in the genitalia. Things that you can do with humans. Even these days, we're hearing a lot of conversation, discussion about the importance of assessing biological differences between the sexes. I think there's no doubt when you examine no human species that understanding those biological sex differences is crucial to understanding the human phenomenon. The second one is about the evolution of pair bonding and fatherhood. Again, on the left, we're seeing a drawing. We cannot reconstruct what those early humans were doing. But we can have a window into the past by looking at what the titi monkeys, the owl monkeys, or myself were doing when we had newborns. And we think that our research is showing that there is a critical period when if we create circumstances for human fathers to involve, to engage with infants, they are much more likely to become devoted, committed fathers. With that, I would like to thank all of the people who made possible this presentation, and of course, thank our funding agencies and institutional partners, and thanking you, the audience, for listening and for participating in this motivating symposium. Thank you.